Bethel World Outreach Church. Reaching a city to touch the world.
Yeah, it's a good place to do it. Thank you, Lord, in the name of Jesus for being here, for doing extraordinary things, those which we perceive and those which we perceive not. I'm asking you, God, to continue to move by your Spirit. Reveal your word to us, Lord. God, think through my mind and speak through my mouth. Let the words of my mouth and meditation of my heart be accepted in thy sight. You're my strength and redeemer, and every glad and happy heart say amen. Amen. I bring you greetings this morning, Bethel. I bring you greetings for those online. Greetings to you who are in the upper venue. I want you to know that if you're following along in a small group or you're watching the AD series at night, to keep on applying, to keep reaching out to your neighbors. And on Wednesday, we have a follow-up. And we have a forum online where you can ask questions or you can hear, you know, what does the Bible say about some of the things in the actual mini-series that may not be in the Bible. Amen. All right, because that can happen. Now, Romans 8:31. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? The beginning of this church in Acts, from the people obeying God, going to get filled with the Holy Spirit, going out and preaching, calling Jesus Lord, seeing people filled with the Holy Spirit, 3,000 one day, 5,000 the next day, everybody, every believer having everything in common, laying down money and provision at the disciples' feet. You can see the community beginning to build. They are meeting daily in the temple, and they're still meeting house to house because they don't have a kind of their own building or meeting place yet. It's like a very communal environment, and everybody is just exchanging what they need with one another to make sure they can make it. They are being persecuted. They're in Jerusalem, the hottest place that they can be in for the message that they're assigned to give. And in the midst of it, they're repeatedly giving the right message. Peter and John found themselves preaching again, thrown in prison for what they were preaching. An angel comes and opened the door. Not the door, the dough. And they run out and they are dragged back in front of Caiaphas. This is the same murderer who killed Jesus. This is the same group of people who are frequently comfortable with sentencing people to death. This is the environment that he is living in. John and Peter and all the disciples are living in, and yet they're still preaching. Gamaliel basically hears all of this is going on, and instead of allowing them to be stoned or killed at that point, says, leave them alone, because if what they say is not true, they'll be like all of the other posers who have ridden in his place saying that they are true and have lost their life. But if they are telling the truth, then we will find ourselves not in a fight with man, but in a fight with God. There's a lot of fights you can get in, and there's a lot of people that can come to your rescue. But getting in a fight with somebody that has God behind them is not a good idea. You know, God will defend you. God will take care of you. When I was growing up, it was my sister, Kenya, who took care of me. I was weak and I was scared and scary about everything, and I was always teased and bullied and picked on. You can tell that, you know, I'm just a product of being bullied, and you know, all my stories, as you know, because you bullied so long, then you just come out and you're just going to fight everybody. Yeah, that's how it happened. I remember being threatened and slapped around, and my sister came and defended me. And she whooped up on a couple of guys. I ran. Got in trouble later, but that's another story for running. My point is that if you have somebody that's for you who can do damage to other people, you talk different. You ever meet those people? They not been in a fight themselves, but they talk like they can fight? Yeah, that was me. That was me, because I knew I had my big sister who would take you out. No problem. These disciples have a very present help in God. The Holy Spirit is not just dwelling in them, but upon them. They are very bold with their message, and they're not themselves defending themselves or fighting against it. They're only speaking as the Holy Spirit gives them permission and counting on God to go before them. But God has a man of their own counsel, Gamaliel, stand up in the midst of them about to lose their life and say, you know what, wait a minute, let's spare them. So when you are full of the Spirit doing what God says do, when fear comes in and tries to prevent you from saying yes to the Lord, give him a chance to show up on your behalf. Now, whenever you advance in the kingdom, I'm telling you that there's things that can be done to resist you. For the first time 2 days ago, I drove down Granny White. Hadn't driven down Granny White. I hadn't seen, they told me there was some signs out against Bethel, but I hadn't seen the sign with our name and then the red X through it, like, you know, stop Bethel. You're like, and I was like, wow. And then they go down far. You're like, you know, one sign would be like, I can take that. Not 20 signs. And all we are doing is advancing the kingdom. We're not doing anything out of the ordinary, but when you have an assignment from God to reach your community, to reach your city, and do it in such a way that pleases him, where every group, every ethnicity can be welcome into one house. Sometimes there seems to be a resistance that comes up, but you don't worry about it, because if God be for you, who can be against you? And I'm going to tell you, you know, you're going to have times when something's against you. The whole message today is that the early church, just because they got the Holy Spirit, was not exempt from problems, was not exempt from persecution, was not exempt from trouble. But for all of the trouble, for all of the persecution, there is a solution, a formula. But if you do not actually use the formula, you'll get a negative outcome. But if you use the formula for your problems, you can get a positive outcome. I want to go to Acts 6 today, and we're going to be talking about the life of Stephen. And I'm going to have you guys do something unique, because it'll help me preach it better. I'm going to have everybody read the Bible in church together. It's powerful. So y'all ready? Ready? Read. Stop. When numbers increase, what comes? Whenever you get more people, there's more problems that all of those eyes can see. Everybody now notices everything that's going wrong, and you get complaints. The carpet has been this color for 25 years. But the more people that come, they start, why won't they change this car? We saving money. Why they don't want us to have coffee in it? Because if you spill coffee on the old carpet, then we'll have to spend money to replace it. Complaints. People have the ability to see things more clearly when it's a crowd. They get more. It's complaints. Numbers increase. 3,000, 5,000, multiply thousands, and now complaints, not from outside. This complaint is arising from within. Read. Stop now. The first complaint in the early church had to do with the difference or the differentiation between how certain ethnicities were treated versus others. The first conflict is an ethnic conflict within the church. The moment that we let the other people in, whoever the others are, I don't know who the, just the others, problems come. See, this is not a new devil. Where Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. said the most segregated hour is Sunday morning at 10 o'clock, and we found that the statistic has not changed. Now, I know you're going to a multi-ethnic church, but still, this is not the standard. So there, this is an adversary that comes in and gives us something that we can see to complain about, and it's birthed by understanding more of who you are than who someone else is or what they need. Let's take it even deeper. The problems that come because maybe you don't have a special needs child in the church. Here's a very neglected group. If I had a special needs child, we probably have all kinds of stuff going on. Isn't that funny? How the moment that it's your thing, then now you big on what need to happen. See, that's a problem. Why aren't we concerned about where are they at? Just like when you don't see certain ethnic groups in, that's got to be a problem to you. God wants us all to be together. And you got to reach out to them. No, we need all of y'all. So when you see the sick and the infirm and the blind and the halt, God actually commanded this church and commanded the scripture for us to go out and compel them to come in because the people with infirmities need help to get to the house. You don't have to say, hey, man, it would hurt me too when God was giving it to me. Because the reality is that as non-self-centered as I want to think I am, I'm still self-centered. The virus is that big that it can show up in the first church. Resources. They widows getting taken care of. What about our widows? People watch the resources. What y'all spending money on? And what about our group? See those two tensions? They exist in the first church. Problems. The more you advance in life, the more things you acquire, the more problems you're going to have. The more money you have, the more people that need to get the money you got. I'm telling you, everybody, every nonprofit in the city, going, you put the church asking you, your kids asking you, family members asking you. You blessed. That's the price. Pay it. Who much is given, much is required. Got to have them all. Y'all want me to go to another point? And I'm thinking about staying right here, but I won't. All right, let's ready? Read. Y'all not gonna make me stop ministering the word and prayer to solve disputes that you qualified to handle, to get involved in things that would weaken the church's growth and its ability to be covered and safe and sound and whole, because you've got a real myopic problem that you think the preacher or the leader ought to handle. And they were handling it. They tried. I would try to pick up all of the paper that a few thousand people came on the grounds today and didn't pick up. We all have the same responsibility to solve the problem. But we all have different roles that we play from God in order to get it solved. Then he does this when he brings the problem to a solution or to a formula. He says, let me get all of y'all together. Let me show you how you guys can solve this. I want you to find men from among you. The answer is always in the house. The answer is always in the church. The answer is always sitting next to you. But if you want to know what it looks like, it's a man that's already with you, that's full of the Spirit, not just the indwelling of God on the inside, saying yes with a pure conscience to making Jesus Lord, but a man who's got God on the outside, and they kind of shine like a light. It's obvious that they want to reflect the glory of God. And then find also a man full of wisdom. The Bible says that the wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom. But in all you're getting, get an understanding. Wise people depart from evil. Wise people keep themselves pure. So find a man that's among you, spirit within and spirit upon, who knows how to stay out of looking at the wrong thing, touching the wrong stuff, and is an obvious example. Y'all need to start saying amen. This is some important, yeah, you know, don't make me, as a pastor, you got to say amen in the right spots. We will part. Help yourself on this. Find them. That's when you are not known by another person in your church or around you, and you're living in isolation. He that is left alone, you're going to meet destruction. You will. I'm telling you to get into a small group so you can be known. I'm telling you to make a friend at church so you can be known. Because right now, you're going to work or school, back to home, and isolated and alone, and occasionally you'll do one activity with other people. Don't build deep relationships. Go back to your lonely pattern to find out when you have a problem or something to celebrate, there's no one to call. Get that baritone amen going, I'm telling you. The solution, get around some folk. The early church was with each other every day. Coming to y'all house. What's your address? Every day, hanging together. The solution, men full of the Spirit. And you get to pick. God always trusts his body. Ready? Read. That's my formula. It happens to me, so now y'all know. Now you know. Go ahead. Now, here's the solution. Here's the solution. Did y'all read verse 7 yet? Okay, read that. No, don't read it. Stop. Okay. Because that's my next spot. Guys, look at this. When you do your part and I do my part, we begin to see the answer unfold. The solution is always in the house. There were people's names who came up right away. Well, I know them. Sister Jones, Brother Ron. Yes, they got all them qualifications. And then you start getting the needs met. Not taking the people who are paid to pray and get in the word and do stuff. And we all got to work the parking lot. And then we pay the, did you see the people with the neon vest on today and everything? We pay them. Because the solution in the house haven't shown up yet, like men to come and work the dusty parking lot. So we pay. Praise God. But we don't need to pay. We need the people in the house, because then we got Pastor JT out there greeting all y'all and they're checking on the shuttle. He drove the shuttle today. Do you know this man fixes more marriages than anybody else here? Your marriage got a problem, call him and his wife. you're going to be straightened out. So what you want to do? You want them to run the shuttle? Or you want them to help your marriage? Because it's something that he prepared his life to do, to give you an expertise. But if we don't work together for the solution, we got the formula, but you got to work it. Who is the man that's the shuttle driver? Can you please identify yourself? Please. We need you. Okay? They knew the people. So you know what? It might be somebody in your life. It might be somebody sitting next to you. You just look. Go to looking around right now and see if you see the glory on somebody. Just look. Just don't turn your neck and just look around. It might be, you know what? Eyeball somebody. Uh-huh. I know. I don't ever see them doing nothing. They got the spirit right on them. That's an anointing. That great. Look, people that see, you know, people, it's a pointing spirit in here too. Yep, them. Mm-hmm. Don't forget you. The three that's pointing back at you when you're pointing. The solution is in the house. And here's the outcome. When the preachers and pastors and leaders are doing what they're uniquely designed to do, and those in the body with the same spirit's anointing are doing those multiplicity of things that they're uniquely wired to do that are beyond maybe standing up here or doing some quote unquote big stuff. Watch the result. Ready? Read. The word, the light, the lamp, the sword continue to do his work. Read. The people who can carry the word, live the disciplines of the word fully, they begin to increase and stand up. Read. Wait a minute. The hardest people to adjust and change on the planet that probably were giving their yes and amen to the crucifixion of Jesus Christ, they starting to say, look, there's too many signs. I can't hear but so much of the real word of life. I can't hear the Old Testament scriptures applied in this new revelatory way that's clear to me and reject. I'm going to turn from this madness. You work in the governor's office, but you don't speak to the governor. You work as a state official, but you don't stick to any officials. Why are you staying silent? You are designed by God to advance the kingdom from your cubicle or from the wherever you at, in the mail room, in the corner office. You was designed all over this city to be a light. I'm a sign. Because I'm in the house. But when everybody was doing so, they got the outcome. The outcome was the kingdom kept growing. People kept coming. And the hardest people to reach, God, it couldn't be that simple. His yoke is easy. His burden is light. Ready? Read. Now, the reason you stop here is because I thought he was given the low job of dealing with the little widows and the little ethnic tension. I thought he was given the insignificant work. But the Bible says that they had laid their hands upon them, assigned them to the work, empowered them for the work, stirred up a greater spiritual presence and ability in them for the work, and the outflow of the work was an increase in gifting, an increase of approval to work in your gift. But if you don't find yourself serving, maybe you won't reach the fullest potential you have in the spirit. Now we have someone that's not the 12 being named as a miracle worker. I thought this work was for the high folk, the spiritually educated, those that walk with Jesus. I didn't know that those that received the infilling of his spirit were able to work in the same power as they align with their spiritual assignment from God and with man. When they're sandwiched in between the opinions of people and the approval of their leaders and the anointing of the Spirit, they not only do what's designed to be done in the house, but they begin to get an outflow out of the house, and people get miracles everywhere and touched everywhere. Stop thinking that the road to success is some long road to a top platform where you can finally be heard by thousands, and start taking your seat wherever God has given it to you, and be faithful to your post, and watch the same anointing from God come upon you, and you'll be able to see the same miracles done that they saw done. This is your portion, Bethel. Pastor Rice is not the greatest evangelist here. He's the one that is equipping the greatest evangelist that will be. You need to say, oh, I need to get in on this equipping. Pastor Steve Merle is not the greatest disciple maker. He is equipping the greatest disciple makers that will be. Yes, you've been prophesying. I see sunflowers. That's too small. You got to graduate. I see the sun. Yeah, the sun is out. Right now. Just, you got to upgrade these prophecies. Get specific. What specifically, not generally, is he saying? Well, I don't know if I'm there. Get serving. Get a little deeper in investing your time, your talent, and your treasure in the kingdom. And then a greater anointing comes on you. Stop wanting to be approved for greater service because you sat around and studied a little longer. You know where all the studiers are in this story? Up knowing that they're up there accusing Jesus. They didn't outsmarted themselves. Studied themselves into a corner. And that's not anti-study. Got to be balanced with it. Ready? Read. Along. Read. Read. Here it is. There was a problem in the Bible. It was ethnic. It was resources. It was solved by the people finding somebody that could be full of the Spirit, wisdom, and known. It was approved by the leaders. That was the solution. The outcome was the preachers kept their job. The people had their job. And then a lot of people got saved. And then Stephen got upgraded to somebody that was real anointed. But then he started really opening his mouth. I ain't just going to pray for people. I'm gonna preach it a little bit. I'm going to tell y'all something what the word is saying. Look how qualified he was. Look how, if you read in Acts chapter 7, you can see how excellent his dissertation is about the beginning all the way up until the point now that the Holy Spirit has been given, and how they have systematically rejected everything that's going on. But when you begin to speak the word, a scheme can be released against you to stop you from speaking the word, because it's the entrance of the word that brings light and life, and the gospel brings light. And if your gospel be hid, it's here to them that are lost. The moment that you start preaching the gospel, there's something that has to come out to resist you. And this is the reason why we don't preach it, because we don't want to be resisted. But Stephen had invested his time, talent, and treasure so deeply into the early church that he couldn't even resist the temptation to keep on speaking the word and seeing the miracles come about. And even when the scheme was against him, his enemies had to say about him, his face like an angel. I don't like the God he serves. I don't like what he's about. But there's something coming off of him that I cannot say it's motivated from an evil place. Stop looking at everything that's going wrong in the world and getting an attitude. Did you see what happened on the news? Let one more thing happen. One more thing happen. That's what I heard somebody say. Let one more thing happen. I'm going off. Come back. The way that they were handling problems was by preaching the gospel and ministering to people. And even when the heat was on, they found themselves looking and projecting such a godly image that it was considered angelic. What are you projecting when you at work and you hear somebody say something to you? I've been at work. I don't know what you remember that ethnic divide. I don't know what your little ethnic word is from your group. When you hear somebody say it, you know, you stand up. Like if I hear somebody say, hey, boy, like somebody said to me, you know, it's. Are we back there? We way back there? Hey, boy. That's your flesh. But you got to hear all of these words as invitations for you to go with the love of God and the words that come from God and the healing that come from God and the grace that comes from God. Stephen was filled with grace. That means he has space to give people to be out of order so that he can bring some order. Stop letting yourself be shipwrecked with the things that sinners do in society. Oh, the world's going. Oh, did you see Nightline? Oh, did you see CNN? Oh, it's getting bad. Oh, it's real bad. No, as long as you're on the planet full of the Holy Spirit, as long as you're under leadership, you can be launched into a community, into a neighborhood, and in a minute it'll be changed. And I don't care what scheme they have against you. Solution. Now, the outcome for him was that even though they knew he was good, they wanted to kill him. And the Bible says that they did just that. They got stones, stoned him, but the Bible says they saw Jesus. He saw Jesus standing at the right hand of God the Father. I thought he was seated. He was standing up, receiving him. And Stephen said this, forgive him. For they don't know what they do. When you're out of place and problems keep you down and keep you separated and you're not part of the solution, the anointing on your life doesn't increase. The availability of your life didn't increase. And how to please God with your life, even if that means laying it down, doesn't become clear enough for you to do it. And even at the point of his death, he was so focused on Jesus that the Bible says that he just fell asleep. He was looking up to Jesus. They were stoning him and hating him, and he was loving them. Don't get back at the world for his sin by looking down on him. Don't get back down on a church because it has problems. The church got it wrong with special needs, period. Period. The church gets it wrong with different ethnic groups. Yeah, but don't get God down on them. We just become the solution to every problem that we face. If you agree with this, stand to your feet, give God praise as I dismiss you. Come on now. Don't pity Patty.
Hi, my name is Pastor James Lowe, and I want to thank you for watching today. A scripture that comes to mind is Romans 10:9. It simply says this, if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. And after listening today, I know many of you want to make that confession. I would love the opportunity to lead you in prayer. And if you would just repeat after me, I believe the Lord is going to meet you today. Say, Lord Jesus, come into my life for the rest of my life. I acknowledge that I am a sinner and I need you a savior. I believe that you died on a cross for me, but on the third day, you were raised from the dead. And with this confession from my heart, I'm no longer the same. But Jesus is now Lord of my life. Now, many of you just prayed that prayer, and I believe you just received salvation. Now, what is your next step? Get in a Bible-believing church. Now, many of you may say, this is my church, and I want you to go to BethelWorld.org and all of the information that you need to get planted, and get involved, and get engaged here is going to be there for you. I want to leave you with this message, that God loves you so very much, and I do too. God bless.
Bethel World Outreach Church, reaching a city to touch the world.